Hello. So how's everyone going? Yeah, sick. Welcome to Tales from MEV Land, or how a below average programmer found his way into searching. I want to clarify, by searching I mean MEV searching, or searching for opportunities or value extraction opportunities on Ethereum or any other L2s. So a little bit of background, I'm just an average curious guy who happened to code, I'm currently suffering from jet lag, so I apologize if I mess up some words. And English is my second language as well, so you can check out my Twitter, my GitHub, and my website, libevm.com. I kind of like to think of myself as, you know, the left curve. If you have to graph like IQ distributions, I would kind of be on like the left side. I've met a lot of my friends, you know, they're really smart people, probably on the mid to high curve, but they don't execute. They think too much. They don't execute. So that's like my little pet peeve with them. But overall, that is probably where I stand. I know where I stand in this hierarchy, if you will. The point of showing you that thing is that if I can do it, you can do it too. If I can extract value from Ethereum, you can extract value from Ethereum too. This is not a very technical game. It's just a mind game, if you will. Whew. All right, story time. Let's head back to DeFi 2020, the DeFi Summit 2020, where things was a little bit more optimistic. We had, you know, YAM, we had the food farming seasons, you know. DeFi Summit 2020, the YAM emoji was on full force. You would see it on Twitter everywhere. We would have like four-digit APY yields, APR yields, you know, not APY, APR, very clear distinction. Eternal Lands, the new pool tool, just launched. Everyone was very optimistic about YAM's future. Everyone's delegating YAM to save YAM. DeFi 2020. Food farming was in high gear. You would see YAM, Bao, Sushi, Pickle, Hot Dog, Kimchi, all the various food tokens. You know, if you could name a food, you had a dot finance. You would probably get into like a website which has like a connect button. And, you know, being the curious farmers we are, we would hit connect. And sign random transactions, maybe even approve random tokens. Those were the good days. Something I would like to emphasize as well is that back in the day, DAI was the preferred stablecoin over USDC. Like the full decentralized finance meme was in its highest gear. People didn't like USDC. People didn't like USDT. DAI from MakerDAO was the preferred stablecoin to yield farming. In fact, it was like preferred. Naked staking, meaning that you would just stake DAI in this particular pool and you get like food tokens or governance tokens, if you will, by simply doing nothing. In fact, the demand for DAI was so high that it would often exceed the market price for DAI would exceed a dollar. I'm talking relative to USDC, by the way. So it would in fact go to as high as like $1.03, $1.02 on the open market. Even though it was supposed to be a stable coin. This is like a very key distinction that I would like to emphasize, because a stable coin going above a dollar does not make it stable at all. Oh yeah, it's a decentralized stable coin. DAI is a decentralized stable coin as opposed to USDC. So a little bit brief, like for people who don't know what DAI is, it's basically a stable coin that is issued by MakerDAO. So how it works is that it's an over-collateralized stablecoin. So you would put in some collateral, most commonly ETH, and you get to mint DAI. DAI, and you get to, if you would like to retrieve back your collateral, you have to refund DAI. So that was like the key distinction. Let's assume that, and I'll give you one example right now. Let's assume ETH is like $100. If you would like to mint 100 DAI, which is supposed to be $100, you would put in you would put in 1.5 ETH to mint 100 DAI, assuming we're at 150% collateralization ratio. Now, this was back in the CDP days, or like the collateralized debt position. So it only allowed for single asset collateralization in MakerDAO. Eventually, it moved on to something called the MCD, which is the multi-collateral DAO, where you could stake multiple assets, USDC being one of them, into Maker. This was a very controversial decision because Maker was supposed to be this decentralized alternative to USDC, but including USDC as an asset, a collateral class for DAI seemed a bit counterintuitive. But nevertheless, it happened, and you could mint 100 DAI with 110 USDC. I know people are like having a lot of question marks. Why am I telling this story about stablecoins when it's a talk about MEV? But I promise it will be relevant later on. Yes, so 110 USDC to 100 DAI. OK, let's rewind a little bit. One DAI trades for approximately 1.02 to 1.03 USDC. I know a lot of you guys probably won't care, but you know, these are juicy, juicy arbitrage opportunities if you are able to find the opportunity. So Maker went from 110% collateralization ratio to 101 collateralization ratio. And this was done through the government's proposal. In fact, it took like I think a week or two before everyone settled on 101% collateralization ratio. In fact, it was like 110, 105, 104, 3, 2, 1. But 101 was the preferred. Everyone voted for 101. Now, does anyone see the opportunity here? This is only through a governance proposal and knowing that DAI trades for above market price. Yes, yes. So you can do it exactly. So my brother in Christ mentioned that you can now arbit because DAI is trading above 101, meaning you can mint. You can mint one DAI for 101 USDC. I'll go into further detail how you would arbitrage this on Curve, which was the primary market for selling and buying DAI back then. But essentially, you went from 100, you went from being able to mint 100 DAI using 110 USDC. Now you can mint it with 101 USDC. So like a whole 9% was cut off. Again, this is on Curve.finance. It was the money printer of my days, 2020. So you could trade one DAI would give you 102 USDC. Whoa, it's you know, it's not does not sound like much, but when you extrapolate this with many more zeros, that 1 cent suddenly becomes $10,000, $100,000. So I call this a bespoken path, if you will. It's basically an alternative route other than the mainstream way of obtaining DAI. So this is how you would print money. Let's say on DAI, if DAI was trading on the market for more than 101 USDC, and let's just say DAI was trading for 102 USDC, what you would do is flash loan 100 DAI, swap it to 102 USDC on Curve, recollateralize 101 USDC, and mint 100 DAI on Maker. Now you repay that loan, and you would profit 1 USDC. That's a lot of work. Add more zeros, maybe it's worth it, maybe it's not, you tell me. But yes, keep in mind, this was done in DeFi summer 2020 when I was hand-arbing this in the public mempool. And I remember my transaction being pending for a few blocks. Market was super inefficient back then, but you know, profit's profit. Sometimes it wasn't done algorithmically. We're like calculating it by hand. Ooh, okay, it's trading above 101 now. Okay, let's put in $10,000 and see if it works. Sometimes we lost money. Sometimes we didn't. But you know, it worked. That's all I really wanted to emphasize on. So yeah, what's the point of telling you all these stories? The point is that you know there's always more opportunities. Market is super inefficient for the long tail stuff. Short tail stuff these days, it's extremely competitive simply because of the existence of flashbots and various like MEV groups. But back then, long tail is extremely inefficient. Does anyone remember the ApeCoin fiasco? People would flash loan bored apes and mint out ape tokens. I think the guy made like $500,000. For like one block, and in fact, he was late by a couple minutes doing that. So all these long tail stuff, if you can dig deep into like the governance proposals, or if you know what's happening in the future, these long tail opportunities are extremely profitable, still profitable, simply because the market is inefficient. Oh yeah, so how do I get started? Yeah, pick your poison: long tail, short tail. What are you good at? Do you want to level up in your technical skill, or do you want to make money? I guess. Yes, two options. And to clarify, long tail opportunities are opportunities that are high in margin, but they come very rarely. Short tail opportunities are very frequent opportunities, for example, arbitrage, but the margins are extremely low. So think like back running or sandwiching. Not that I do any sandwiching. But yeah, it's very frequent, but it's extremely competitive. Long tail is less competitive. But the frequency isn't there, but the margins are there. So pick your poison. So yeah, how do I get started? I guess, what's your strength? Are you good at infrastructure? Are you good at code efficiency? Are you good at recon? By recon, I mean staring at Etherscan or staring at Flashbots Explorer for hours on end, trying to see, are there any competitors to this strategy? Or can I somehow be better than this particular MEV searcher? And also, find a team. You can't really, it's 2 to 3 people is the optimal size. You know, too many cooks kind of spoil the broth, sort of analogy. And so you kind of have to share profits, not ideal, but it's better to cover more ground, in my opinion, with a team. You can cover more ground and gain more profits. You know, good artists borrow, great artists steal, Justin Sun, 2020. Yeah, so if you see, the cool thing about MEV and blockchain, if you will, is that everything is public. Every transaction, every opportunity that is extracted is public, unless they're doing some kind of funky sex to dex up. But you can still extrapolate that if you decide to stare at the order books for long enough. But most on-chain opportunities will be public. They are public. In fact, they don't go through Flashbots because people will know, ooh, someone's extracting value from there. But if you decide to stare long enough on Etherscan, the opportunities are there, and you can extract them. Yes, good artists borrow, great artists steal, Justin Sun. Yes, so my favorite tool for this is Etherscan. And how I find opportunities. This is done more programmatically, by the way. But one example, if you would like to dive deep into this, is through Etherscan. If you'd like to just quickly get your hands wet, get your feet wet, is to use Etherscan. Notice that this transaction has a function signature, which is not identified. Because if you look at all the other transactions, I don't know if you guys can read it, probably not, but it has identifiable function names like multi-call, claim, fill ask, atomic match. But occasionally, you might find a function signature that is completely unrecognizable. That is usually someone doing some funky stuff. Usually. So click into that. Kind of see the transfer events. Check out what's happening. You know, are there any funny token transfers? Is he putting in $40 and getting out $42? Is he putting nothing and getting out something? Because that does happen more often than you think. Or the alternative, if you want to do a long tail strategy, is to join some obscure protocol on Twitter or Discord. You know, comb through all the discussions. And find out, oh, this governance proposal is going to change this parameter on this curve that suddenly creates a huge op opportunity. I remember when Synthetics was deploying the ETH wrapper. I don't know if anyone remembers that, but back then, ETH to ST, to Synthetics ETH, S-ETH, not ST-ETH, a clarification that I need to make. So S-ETH is ETH that was trading on Synthetics, and then they launched a pool on curve where you could trade between ETH and S-ETH. SEF was very SEF that there wasn't much volume on SEF, so there was a oversupply on ETH on the curve. Essentially, what that meant was that SEF was trading for a premium on curve. So one ETH could net you 1.01 SEF. And keep in mind, this is when ETH was 3 to 4K, not like the bear days right now. But Synthetics created a governance proposal to launch this thing called the ETH wrapper, where you could immediately mint, you could mint a ETH to SEF at a 1-to-1 ratio. And now you could swap that, now you could mint ETH to SEF and trade it for a premium later on. One SEF gave you 1.01 ETH, not the other way around. Something I want to clarify, yes. But yeah, if you dig deep enough to these governance proposals and you stay long enough on the Discord, you know, you be active on the chats, you know, these. You do find some golden nuggets. And in fact, you only need one opportunity like so, because this was a 6 to 7 figure opportunity. It was about, I think, 200 to 300 ETH when ETH was 3 to 4K. So you do the math. Not like I got anything from it, but yes. So I realize I spoke really fast, probably because you guys are extremely attractive, which made me extremely nervous. But please realize that the market is super inefficient. So avoid having imposter syndrome. Pick your poison, you know, long versus short tail. What do you want to do? You want high margin, low frequency, high frequency, low margin. You know, playing your strengths. Yes, playing teams. So if you're good at infrastructure, layer two is probably your game, because you need to figure out, okay, well, how do I get this transaction to propagate faster than other people? Or if you're, sending up the infrastructure, like doing information surfacing. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of work that feels like busy work. It's a lot of, yeah, you're just running in circles. But if you want to do MEV, I guess you got to do what you got to do. If you enjoy gas golfing, you know, do it on Ethereum L1. It's very fun. The infrastructure is built from you. Thank you, Flashbots. I was going to be a Flashbots community manager, but they denied my application. So if anyone's hiring for community managers, please let me know. Yeah, find a team. Yeah, play your strengths. And yeah, that's the end of my talk. Any questions? I see we're all speechless apart from my brother in Christ. So the question was, what's the favorite long tail strategy? My favorite long tail strategy is this function called give birth on CryptoKitties, where if you call give birth, you're rewarded some ETH for some reason. Sometimes, I mean, it's not very profitable, but it's quite interesting. There's like this one account doing like 100,000 transactions just calling give birth for CryptoKitties, which is still profitable today. But yeah, now that I mentioned it, it's probably no longer profitable. Yes. Yep. No more questions? Well, speechless. Great. Have a good night. You know, save the best talk for last. Thank you.